Let's begin then with the gathering music. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I would like to welcome you all, and especially to welcome a brand new person into our midst. On Thursday, Isabel Rose was born to Amy and Andre, and everything is going well. So that's always exciting to have a brand new birth. Also, I'd like to just welcome you all to be part of the worship today. Obviously, Pastor Tom is not here, and he is actually at Synod Assembly. Today, you're going to hear the disciple Peter ask kind of what you might even think is sort of a smart-alecky question, because he says to Jesus, how many times are we supposed to forgive somebody? Seven times? And he figured, I figured seven was a large number for him. But wait till you hear the answer. So we'll look forward to that. Let us begin with a call to worship. May we remember
that God created.
May we remember
that God liberated.
May we remember. May we remember
that God is still creating, God is still liberating, and God is still feeding us.
Let's let this be our story.
Let us begin.
Let us worship the Holy God. Please stand. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord God, merciful judge, you are the inexhaustible fountain of forgiveness. Replace our hearts of stone with hearts that love and adore you, that we may delight in doing your will, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
And the children want to come up front? So it's good to see you all, and I wanted to ask you, in the gospel for today, it starts off by one of Jesus' disciples, Peter, saying to Jesus, how many times am I supposed to forgive somebody? Seven times? Have you ever thought about, have you had to forgive somebody for something that they did? Have you? Yeah. And sometimes it can be kind of hard to do that, isn't it?
Yes, and sometimes if you do something, you're not ready to forgive.
That's right, because you're not ready, because maybe it hurt. And here's Peter, he's saying, well, how many times am I supposed to forgive somebody? And he just wants to know, how does he relate to people when he feels that they have hurt him or broken a relationship? And it's interesting because the answer that he gets from Jesus, I think, shocked him, because Jesus said 70 times 7. Do you know your math? Probably not. Well, that's a lot. And Jesus was saying to to Peter, and he says to us today, is that when someone does something that maybe hurts us, or we feel like they have done something kind of mean to us or something, that Jesus says it's important for us to forgive them, because that's how we keep in relationship with people, even with people who maybe have been mean to us.
I also know everything about people.
Yeah, it's important to know a lot about people. And so it's important to remember that if somebody hurts you or says something against you, it's okay to forgive them. And later in the sermon, I'm going to talk more about that. But I think it's just important for us to always know that that's what we have all been invited to do, is if someone has hurt us in some way or another, and it could be in a small way or a big way, but Jesus is inviting us to forgive them. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the message that Jesus gave to Peter about forgiveness. We hope that we're able to understand and do that kind of forgiveness with our friends and our family and neighbors, so that if we feel they have hurt us in some way, we can forgive them and be back in better relationship with them. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's reading is from St. Paul's letter to the Romans. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then, each of us will be accountable to God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 18th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he could not pay, the Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all their possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of the slave released him and forgave him his debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii, and seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then this fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, I will pay you. But he refused, and he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly depressed, and they went to reported to the Lord all that had taken place. Then his Lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you had pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, the Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to you, every one of you, if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So I have a question for you all this morning. How many times do you think you've already sinned today? How many times? Maybe 1,000? Well, that happened to me when I was in 10th grade in Sunday school. We were all sitting there, all 15-year-old kids had just been to worship, and our Sunday school teacher comes in and says that very same thing. Well, how many times have you sinned today? And we all were stumped. We had no idea how to answer that one. And then he said, probably 1,000 times already. Well, needless to say, as a 15-year-old, hearing that, it was pretty devastating. And I'm not sure he got his point across, but he did mark me, because that was 65 years ago. Anyhow, I'm not going to do that to you. So one of the things that I was really always very fascinated by was that, as growing up and, you know, becoming a teenager and then in like in college, you hear this scripture and you think, you have to forgive 70 times 7? Whew, that's a lot. And it's like, what went wrong here? There's, you know, Peter didn't have such a bad number, 7, you know, because sometimes it's like are you supposed to have the same person violate you 7 times and you can forgive them all 7 times and the 8th time then you can not? I don't know. But it poses a really incredible dilemma for us when we read it this way. When I was in seminary, I was studying Greek, and in order to read the New Testament in the Greek language. And so that was quite a challenge at times, but it was also really enlightening, because how many of you have heard of the concept of infinity before? It's a math concept, yeah. You remember what the symbol is it for? Yeah, okay. Well, that was actually just created in the last probably 200 years by mathematicians. They came up with that name for infinity. But in the Greek language, in Jesus' time, 2,000 years ago, 70 times 7 was their equivalent of saying infinity. So we can't take this literally here, that we're supposed to do it like 70 times 7. No, he was basically saying to Peter, an infinite number of times is the number of times that we forgive. So that's kind of shocking when we hear Peter asking that question, how many times should a person be forgiven? Because Jesus basically said an infinite number. So what do we do with that? One of the things that I have, well, I guess I've always struggled with the sort of the concept of sin, because it seems to be such a large, magnificent sort of word that covers every imaginable thing you can think of. And it also, I think it is so, because it seems so ominous, we really don't know what it means. And one of the things that I did appreciate as I continued to read the scripture in Greek was that we were then reading other portions of scripture, and we discovered that the word sin was taught, they were talking about two kinds of behaviors that happen. One of them is missing the mark. Like, well, I had really intended to come to church every Sunday for this year, but then I missed about 30% of them. Well, that's missing the mark. Or I had really intended to be a good mom or a good dad or a good brother or a good sister throughout this entire year. That was my New Year's resolution. Well, by March, I'd already blown it. That's missing the mark. And all of us, I think, really understand what missing the mark is, because we have, you know, it's like we're not always on target every time. And that's a concept that I think is less, laden with negativity as the word sin. Because I think a lot of times when we think of sinners, we always think of sort of like this is a really, really bad person who's done really, really bad stuff. And basically, one of the definitions is simply they missed the mark. They maybe said they were going to do something, they didn't. Or maybe they said they would not do something, and they did. One of the things, another way that Scripture talks about sin is breaking a relationship. And that often is a way that we don't realize how that can hurt another person. I can't figure out why he hasn't called me. It's been 2 years, you know. I don't know what happened the last time we talked, because we used to exchange emails once a week. I haven't heard from him for a long time. And so it's like something happened. There was a relationship that was broken. And so the question then becomes, how do I deal with that? Or what do I deal with when I know I have broken a relationship? I think once we move away from the concept of sin, which is so loaded, has so many negative connotations, and we think about the behavior that could be considered missing the mark or breaking a relationship, it's easier to understand what it is we're about. And when we're saying, forgive me, I forgive you. And when we do that, it begins to make greater sense of what this scripture is about. So that when Peter is saying, how many times am I supposed to let that person miss the mark or break a relationship? And it's like, Jesus says, well, an infinite number of times. And I think that's the part of being in relationship with our fellow human beings is really what it's all about. One of the things that I'm very aware of is that forgiveness and having broken relationships and missing the mark are hand in glove connected. And so I think it's really important for us to hear Peter say, well, how many times should I forgive this person? Because I think a lot of times we think, you know, it seems like every time I interact with this person, I feel worse. And what's going on? And I think what Jesus was trying to say to Peter was that it's an ongoing part of being a human being to stay in relationship and to not miss the mark with people. So if I say I'm going to call you next week, call next week. You know, and it's like if I'm saying that I wanted to do something for you and I forgot to get it done, to be able to say, well, forgive me. Because what's happening then is we're staying in relationship with one another. And that, I think, ultimately is what God is desirous of us, that we stay in relationship with God. And how do we do that? One of them is to ask for and to give forgiveness, so that we don't then stay in this broken relationship or missing the mark over and over again. One of the things that I know that I have, maybe I've gotten sort of too focused on it, but One of the things that I appreciate when I found what was the definition of sin, i.e. missing the mark or breaking a relationship, it made a whole lot more sense. I could then look at my life and say, where did I miss the mark? Where did I break a relationship? And then to realize that part of relationship and part of sort of saying we're going to do something is fulfilling them. And I think that's what Peter was asking Jesus. How am I going to deal with somebody who doesn't follow through? How many times should I do that? And he says, an infinite number. So that we don't look at it then as we are going to be condemned forever, but we look at it as we are responsible for staying in relationship with one another by maybe fixing up a relationship, patching it, or if we miss the mark, make amends. One of the things that I guess it's maybe a blessing or a curse from being in seminary is that I have found it hard in our worship services to use the word sin because it has no clear meaning or implication or understanding for most people. And when we think of the word, when we see the word sin or say the word sin or hear the word sin, we maybe think of, like when I ask you, how many times have you sinned today already? 1,000? It's like, well, what counts, you know? But when we say the three-letter word, all of a sudden we think of really horrendous, horrible things, like dropping a bomb, or blowing up a house, or cutting people off, never to talk to them again. And we really kind of get exaggerated things in our mind, and then we say, well, I never do that. But the fact is that when we say, have you sinned, most of the time I say, oh, I can't remember what I did the last time. But that doesn't mean that I didn't break a relationship or that I missed the mark. And so having that as the image, it seems like it's a whole lot better for us to then understand what is it that we're to do with our relationships with people. Invited to be in relationship. Invited to do what we say we do. And when we start doing that, it's like it begins to make more sense of being in good relationship with people. And that's really what we're all about here. So for example, when in our liturgy, we'll actually be doing it later today, we say, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. I never can figure out who and what it's all about because it's so vague. And I was thinking, if we said something like, forgive us for the times that I've missed the mark and that I've broken a relationship, I could probably come up with examples of those because they're interpersonal interactions that happen all the time. So I know we're going to continue with forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. I know we're going to continue that. But think differently about it. That what ways did I miss the mark? Or what ways did I break a relationship? And how can I fix that? Because that's really what our invitation is to do. So I have an assignment for you this week, beginning today. I would like you to think about, try using those two categories, missing the mark and breaking a relationship, as a way of reflecting on your right relationship with God and all those around you. I really actually do believe that God wants us to notice those two areas. In other portions of Scripture, that's what is specifically defined as when we are not in relationship with God, we've missed the mark or we've broken a relationship. So just to notice, how does that happen? Notice maybe ways you miss the mark or breaking a relationship as you live out your lives with your family or your coworkers. And then, how can I repair it? Forgive me for neglecting you yesterday. Or I'm sorry that I said I got so wild about something because the traffic was bad coming home and it wasn't because of you. So that's my assignment. Well, how have you missed the mark? And where are broken relationships? And what can be done for repairing them? Amen. Praises, we've listened to Scripture. We've also prayed. Let us now affirm our own faith as we say together the affirmation of faith that is on the screen and in your bulletin. We believe that God is a conversationalist, drawing close to us and asking us, what do we need? Where does it hurt, and who do you long to be?
We see this conversationalist
God, Jesus Christ, God of flesh,
who walked the earth,
speaking the poor and the hungry, and the lonely,
and the outcast.
Therefore, we believe
that our call as people of faith is
to continue this holy conversation with those who look and think like us, as well as those who
share little in common with us.
We believe that through these conversations, we are able to catch a glimpse of the kingdom of God
so we continue the conversation in hope.
Amen.
Remembering the caring and generous works of God, we pray for the church, creation, and the needs of our neighbors. We pray for the church. Bless the missions and ministries of diverse congregations, that they uplift the good news of salvation in ways that can be understood. We pray for creation. Send rain to lands experiencing drought and healing to rivers clogged with pollution. Enrich the soil for trees and plants. Protect the crops needed to feed those who hunger. Walk with all victims whose lives are affected by natural disasters, especially in Maui, Florida, Morocco, and Libya. We bring our prayer to you. We pray for all who govern. Encourage those in positions of power to lead with empathy, practice forgiveness, and care for those who struggle. We pray for our neighbors who face illness of any kind, for those strained financially, for all living with chronic pain, mental illness, the disease of addiction, or otherwise afraid or in harm's way. Protect all who cry out for mercy, especially Elizabeth Abersold, Ardice Miri, Mahira, Joe Bencharski, Rose, Anigrit, and all those we name before you or hold silently in our hearts. We bring our prayer to you.
Let my prayer be a fragrant offering, as incense to you arise.
Renew the lives of those celebrating their baptismal anniversaries, especially Carol Cunliffe, Jeff Reinders, Caitlin Jacobs, and Cornel Church. Bless their lives and stir in their hearts passion for the ministry to which you have called them. We pray for this congregation. Open our hearts to practice intentional invitation. Help us to forgive each other, practice patience, and choose welcome over judgment. Move us to care for those in our community seeking refuge and safety. We bring our prayer to you.
Let my prayer be a fragrant offering, my hands lifted up in praise.
Remember us according to your steadfast love as we offer these and the prayers of our heart, trusting in your compassion made known through Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share that peace with one another.
Peace, peace be with you. Peace, 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 everyone this morning. Peace.
A bunch of announcements just I wanted to alert you to. If you look up, well, later up there, and we're in the back of your bulletin, there will be a special congregational meeting on October the 1st, and that's a really good one to go to. We're going to be talking about the audiovisual equipment and the need for doing some upgrades. That, like that projector up there, when do you think that was bought? 2011. And you know how much technology has changed between 11 and now? Well, we're trying to upgrade. But that'll be an important meeting to come to. Also, I want to mention the adult education. It'll be this Thursday, and it will be at Shepherd of the Hills. Starts at 6:30, and it's going to be called, looking at a book called The Cup of Our Life by Joyce Rupp. And there'll be meeting on Thursdays for 5 weeks.
Okay, good morning. I actually have two hats I'm wearing today. So a week from Wednesday, the 27th, is our weekly opportunity to help with the meal for Jonathan's Place. So there's a sign up in the entryway. We still need some of the foods donated if you are so inclined, some fruits, some vegetables. We're doing an Asian theme chicken dinner, some chicken. We still need chicken too. So if you're so inclined, please bring that to the church by Wednesday, the 27th at 9:30 in the morning, so it's ready for us to prepare and get to the folks at Jonathan's Place. I've spoken with the coordinator there a couple times. They are so appreciative of the meals that we are providing. You may remember when we restarted this in January, the county was still under the COVID restrictions. We had to bring only frozen food, not the healthy, fresh food we're cooking now. So passing on through their coordinator how grateful they are. They look forward to the fourth Thursday every month when Marin Lutheran is bringing the meal. So thank you all for helping with that. And then just real quickly, second hat, jumping on Pastor Seeger's announcement. I'm honored. I will be facilitating the class at Shepherd of the Hills on Thursdays. Pastor Tom and I have been talking about it for several months. It's a wonderful opportunity, and I was struck by some of the lyrics in the songs we were singing today, especially about sharing the richness of our community. So it's you can come and just listen. You can come and participate. It'll be a 5-week series, and really takes the image of the cup being, we are the cup of our life, and how God fills it and uses us to bless each other through our world. So I look forward to teaching that or facilitating, and hope you can come.
Also, I just wanted to thank the various people who make it possible for us to worship today. Paul, with you as assisting minister, and Erna, who was out there greeting folks, and Barb Bischoff, who was handing out bulletins and making sure we all got together here. Robert on keyboard, and Patricia on violin. And who did I miss? Oh, most important people for the world and the outer world, Bev and John doing our technology. So thanks all for making this worship work.
Thank you to all the volunteers who showed up yesterday. The 18
certainly showed up. We had more volunteers than we've ever had. We had 16 people, and I don't know whether it was the salsa music that we added this year, but we cranked out 160 burritos in an hour and a half, and it was very well received. So thank you to all who volunteered.
Let us then continue with the worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and our duty and our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of the angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. If those in the sanctuaries of their home would take the bread and raise it. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same manner also he took a cup when he had supped, and when he had given thanks, gave them all, saying, "Drink ye all of it. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin." Amen. Jesus, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
In the silence, in the hands extended.
Please stand. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Go in peace. Your faith has made you whole. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of the abundant table, you have refreshed our hearts in this meal with bread for the journey. Give us your grace on the road that we might serve our neighbors with joy for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Receive the benediction. God, who creates life, feeds us with love, and liberates us from despair, bless you with truth and peace. And may the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always in the faith, hope, and love. Amen.
Thanks be to God.